Let us pray. Turn us again, O God of our salvation, so the light of your face may shine upon us. May your justice shine like the sun, warming our souls and stirring fires of compassion within us. Jesus, our light, as daylight fades and the lights of evening begin to shine, we give you all thanks and praise. For you shine light into the shadows and corners of our hearts. Bring your healing to that which we would hide even from ourselves. Holy Spirit, you have guided us through this day and brought us to this time and to this place. Grant us an evening filled with peace and a night free from worry. Amen.
Amen.
Before I read our first scripture passage this night, let us pray a prayer for illumination. O God of love, there are so many words in a day, to-do lists and stress, self-talk and notifications. There are so many words, and yet the only words we really need are yours. So tonight we pray, drown out every voice but your own, and speak to us through these texts. For we are craving good news, and we are desperate for your love. With gratitude, we pray. Amen. Our first scripture passage comes from the 139th Psalm. Lord, you have searched me and known me, and you know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away, and you search out my path and my lying down. You are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, and it is so high that I cannot attain it. Where can I go from your spirit, or where could I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there, and if I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take to the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, even there, your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me and the light around me become night, but even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day, for darkness is as light to you. For it was you who formed my inward parts, and you who knit me together in my mother's womb. And I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works that I know very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes beheld my unformed substance, and in your book were written all the days that were formed for me, when none of them as yet existed. How weighty to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. I try to count them, but they are more than the sand. I come to the end. I am still with you.
The second reading is from the Gospel of John, from the third chapter. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a very powerful religious man. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God. Jesus answered him, Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above. Nicodemus said to him, How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born? And Jesus answered, Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus said to him, How can these things be true? Jesus answered him, Are you a teacher of Israel and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him.
So I took our passage from Sunday that we heard, that was at the end of what Victor just read, and I went a few verses before so you could hear the story of Nicodemus. And then I paired it with Psalm 139, in truth, because that's my favorite psalm. But also I think Nicodemus is searching desperately to know the truth of Psalm 139. He wants to know that God loves him. He wants to know that he belongs. He wants to know how this can be. I think Nicodemus might be the first Presbyterian, right? He's not making bold claims when he comes to Jesus. He does it at night. He wants an easy fix. He just wants to be able to get on with his busy life and follow Jesus without a whole lot of inconvenience. And I think he really, though, just wants to know he's okay. I think he's a modern man trying to do the right thing as long as it fits in his busy schedule and doesn't inconvenience him too much. But in his heart, he needs to know that he was knit together in his mother's womb and God was there and God created him. And from God, not a single thing about his life was there. And I think that's what we all want. Jesus doesn't give Nicodemus a free pass to stay with that easy, comfortable life. He challenges him to boldly step into this deeper life of faith and transformation. But I have a lot of sympathy for Nicodemus because I recognize and understand his desire to just rely on what he already knows, to not be pushed too much. But when Jesus meets Nick at night and invites him to be born into new life, it's an invitation there because our God is generous and faithful. And our God did not send the Son to the world to condemn the world, but that we might be saved. So what I'm wondering is, how is this journey of being born again going for you? And how can we, as a community of faith, walk with each other on our journeys, recognizing that there are times when we don't really have the energy or the bandwidth or the time to be pushed and inconvenienced, and yet it's God who's calling us into something deeper. So how can we support each other in that? How can we give each other grace in that? And I don't know if any of you have any actual answers to this. I don't have the answers. But I'll offer it up to you. Being the first Presbyterian that Nicodemus was, right, he also would know about our poet laureate, Anne Lamott, who said, "I don't understand the mystery of grace, mm-hmm. only that it meets us where we are and does not leave us where it got us."
Yeah.
So as we go out into our busy lives where we're scheduled and all of that, I hope we can rest in that grace that will not leave us where it found us, but will travel with us to the ends of the seas. Amen. may not be able to sing inside yet, but Michael, thank you for music that somehow managed to make that piano sing. Amen. Let us pray. O Lord, our God, as we sit in quietness, our thoughts are far from quiet. We are wrestling with doubt and fears. We are looking for answers. We are hoping against hope. We are seeking strength. We are hungry for healed bodies and for rest from tears. Your word says the hungry will be filled, and we ask you tonight to fill us. Fill us with the breath of life. Fill us with thankful hearts. Fill us with calmness, courage, and most of all, with the knowledge of your presence. We offer prayers for those we know and love who are ill, and for those we don't know who are ill. We ask, O God, that you would surround them with your strong, healing presence. Grant wisdom to those who need answers to difficult questions. Grant hope to those who despair, and friendship to those who feel lonely. Most of all, O God, may we know your love, your great love with which you have for each of us. You know the hairs on our head. You count each beat of our hearts. You knit us together when we were being formed, and you know our getting up and our lying down. You are familiar with all our ways, and there is no place we can hide from you. You were there at our beginning, and you will be with us through to the end. So may we not lose sight of your constant care. We look to you, O God, to be present in our communities and in our world. Continue to show us how we at Calvary can be part of your work in the world. Teach us how we can grow into faith and become more and more like Jesus. We also ask the Lord that you would bless the work of our hands and bless all that we offer today, not only the way we give our money, but our offering of time and talents. And now we gather all our prayers together, the spoken and the unspoken. Mm-hmm. And we join our voices praying the prayer you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
care to go back out into the night, receive now this blessing from the Iona community. Bless to us, O God, the moon that is above us, the earth that is beneath us, the friends who are around us, and your image deep within us.